And welcome back to Seat Story Cup 5. My name is TJ. I'm joined on the couch by AKA Wonder and Tice. So we're almost through Group A, about to jump into the cider match, Zixo versus Life Coach. It's been a good day so far. AKA Wonder, man.
Hey, how is it going, guys? It's the main stage. I was casting in the Stream B for 2 hours today. Mm-hmm. So now I'm here. How is it going? How Twitch chat? Hey guys, PogChamps, Kappas, Kipos, everything. It's going fine. I'm excited to see Life Coach, your teammate, and of course Zixo is, you know, two of the best players in the world, we can say.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And what can you say about your teammate?
Yeah, well, it's definitely going to be a good match. Life Coach coming here with not the most like common strategy, really for more control lineup, but also bringing Rogue here and with a more mid-range Shaman. What is, I think, here the most unpopular Shaman now with the aggro and control Shaman being so much around. And it has his strengths, it has his weaknesses, but definitely one he is more comfortable with. And it's also a lineup that should still be like, he's not banning the Zoo, but with some special attacks, I still think he's kind of fine with Zoo, even after losing 3-0 the last round.
Yeah, he went ahead and banned the Shaman away from Zixo. So that's an interesting ban, the mid-range Shaman.
Yeah, it's just in general, like the weakness of the strategy with bringing Rogue is already Shaman. Even if it is a mid-range Shaman, Rogue really suffers there. And if you also go with a bit more like Warrior and that is a bit more control. He plays the Khatoon Warrior, so then you really are weaknesses yourself more against the mid-range Shaman.
And also the Druid, I believe.
Yeah, the Druid also. Better. Like, it's just the deck that you don't want to face, so.
Yeah.
A mid-range Shaman might even be worse than aggro Shaman.
Yeah. Here we see, like, a good start for the Druid against Zoo, because Living Roots is just one of the key cards.
But you keep the second one?
I think so. Because you want to play one Living Roots at the start, and then the other one as a removal.
But I'm not sure about it, but it's a really close call. Like, you want to fit your curve out always well as a Druid, of course. And we see here that 6-0 really came in a tournament with a strategy banning Warrior and Warlock, like a bit between them. Bans then the Warlock from Life Coach, and Life Coach banning the Shaman from 6-0.
I actually don't like playing Living Roots a lot of times on 1 against 2.
Because of Voidwalker, Villager, Squires.
It almost always does 2 damage to trade anyway. The only thing is the mana cost. Like, will you have 2 mana to spare? If you don't have a good curve, I like holding on to Living Roots. If you have a good curve, though, like he does with Wrath and, you know, 4 drops. What do you think of that?
I agree. Sometimes I don't like to play Living Roots, but at the end, I think it's always good to play it because there are some times where the Zoo is not going to play a 1-3 or a 1-1. And even if they do, it's not that bad. It's just 1-for-1 card.
Yeah.
It's a trade 1-for-1. So it's just a tempo play, I could say. Mm. But I have to say that I think I like to keep both Living Roots because later on in the game, Living Roots are not going to be that impactful.
It's still like a decent card. I think the weakness of Druid at the moment is the 3 drop. Like at 4, there is the Keeper, there is the Teacher, there is a Fendril, there is a good Swipe. There are a lot of 4 slots where the 3 slot is just nothing with a Mulch maybe that not really isn't 3 play. So it kind of fits out well against like a Zoo that is a bit of an aggro matchup. Won't mind it too much.
Yeah.
So here is the decision to Rev or to Hero Power, and
it's always the same, right? Because you want to draw one more card, or you want to keep Wrath because he can play a threat on turn 3 or later on, and you want to draw 4-3.
I kind of like to keep the Rev, I think.
I mean, it's too early to decide if you want to spend Wrath. You can just save it and think about it later.
I mean, at the end of the game, in this matchup, you're gonna have like problem with dealing the board, and Rev is just like 3 damage if it kills an impactful minion.
That rope went too fast for Life Coach.
Yeah. Also, you don't have a turn 3 play, so maybe Wrath is there to actually have a play for turn 3 if he doesn't pick anything up.
I think you're looking for Innervate, so maybe Wrath for 1 on turn 3. Maybe a play? or just for free? What do you think, Tides?
I won't do it. Like, if you don't get it, innervate. If you don't get the Wild Growth, your turn is empty. Yeah. And if you now have an empty turn, I mean, you kind of get in the same spot now because of the double minion. But that was only if there will be a double minion in this case.
So could you grab the 3-2 and go face with the 1-1?
I'm like thinking if there is value in reffing for 1 and trade your 1-1 in, like you draw a card this way, you kill your own 1-1.
Yeah, that's what I meant to play this turn.
Yeah, it's either way you're not killing the Dark Peddler.
With the swipe, it makes some sense in the hand to like
leave
this
1-1
up maybe. Mm-hmm. Goes for the Cadre. Life Coach loves to draw, loves to get more options.
He's a greedy player.
Yeah, if there is somebody that is really values draw, it's probably Life Coach.
Yeah.
But still,
well, the main difference by drawing a card or dealing 3 damage was like the 1-1 makes a lot of sense to be in the board if he has Ingham Boss, for example, because you can like swipe and trade. But in this case, the 1-1 is just nothing.
Yeah. So here, that gives more options.
He found it. So now you can choose between Mindkeeper and prepare the next turn, or just Violet Teacher, Innervate, Power of the Wild, which is not the dream right now, but it's good.
Uh-huh. Yeah, Violet Teacher, Innervate, Power of the Wild would give you 4/6 Violet Teacher plus 2/2s.
Yes.
And are you afraid that your opponent's just going to be able to trade up? Because there is a Direwolf Alpha on the board.
I will say, yeah, like the trades are going to be pretty valuable. Might be that not everything will be traded there, but Teacher will die for sure. But with a swipe, you can also make a pretty good cleanup if there is an Argus. If it goes like 2 minions to 3/3.
Yeah.
That's a bit tricky. But yeah, I still don't think like Sixo will leave the Teacher up and then the minions will never survive. I think you kind of want to make the power play here already and not wait with the Mindkeeper. It feels a bit on the slow side. With the 3-1, abusive just trading it away.
What if you play Mindkeeper right now? Next turn, swipe, clean something, and next turn, Violet Teacher combo.
Yeah, but then you kind of rely on a good swipe, and I don't see a good swipe at the moment.
Okay.
Yeah, and you just play it too slow. I mean, that's a 3-turn plan, almost.
Ooh, goes for the Tiger. We didn't even consider this.
No, I didn't.
Oh, this makes the swipe really evil. Like, if Sixo doesn't expect it, like, if there's going to be value trades, then the swipe cleans up the other, like, health from the Direwolf and the Peddler.
Yeah, just going wider actually makes a lot of sense here because, like you said, it makes the swipe easier, and also it makes the trade into the Violet Teacher less impactful. Because instead of being left with 2/2/2s, you're left with 2/1/1s and a 3/2, which is more stats.
Really awkward head here now for Six. So I cannot really see here a good Argus. I cannot really find a good one. If you want to kill the Teacher, maybe you want to leave the Teacher up, but...
No, I don't think so.
But then you are kind of forced to like...
The 1/1s are just... Too good.
But you're either like, then you are forced to trade 2 minions in or play the Soulfire on a really bad curve. So is he always he's going for not killing it.
But now, yeah, I understand, but now like...
That's not too bad. I mean, yeah, the swipe is not good here. It's okay, it's just 1/1.
Mm-hmm. So Astral Drake for sure. Mm-hmm. Because it's hard to trade.
Yeah.
And you have like two different threats on board, Violet Teacher and Azure Drake.
There might be some merit to Mindkeeper as well.
Yeah, but Mindkeeper maybe like too late now. Next turn is you're gonna have 7 mana. What are you gonna do? You have a swipe, you have an Azure Drake and a Scenarios. Innervate is awesome, but you don't have.
What about Mindkeeper for the 2/2? You can swipe Hero Power next turn. Still.
Yeah. That's
like
not the
for now. For now, it won't actually. Normally, I would also say Mindkeeper. You never want to make that 2/2. Like getting one extra coin every turn. But again, Zuwad is just so heavy board game. But it's so impactful. I can see it making more relevant here.
It's more stats than the Azure Drake, but it doesn't fit the curve as well, and it doesn't get the spell power or the card draw, so...
Yeah. But Life Coach, I don't think there are much situations where he likes to play off-curve, where he can play in the curve.
Yeah.
Just really his preference here.
He's a very technical player, and playing on curve is sort of the biggest indication of technical play.
So here you can play Soulfire, but you are going to discard a really good card.
You can start with the Argus.
You can start with Argus, or you can tap to play Soulfire and Wrathward.
Isn't this the dream of Soulfire? Isn't it the reason why it's in the deck? Like trading with Pillagers, Ezreal Drakes, and all these 4 HP minions?
Yeah, it's the dream, but when you discard a really important card, like Argus or Dungwar,
He didn't want the Argus. This is really interesting that he didn't want the Argus. Because he goes for the...
Well, I guess he don't want to increase the odds of discarding Dungwar.
Oh, yeah.
Maybe, this just means he values the Doomguard over the Argus.
Yeah.
Argus, I think, would have been a better play, but it also would have mean the Doomguard was a 50-50 discard instead of a...
Now you can play Fandral, Power of the Wild, or Swipe Hero Power. Swipe is a card where like you want to play when they play the Zero Mana spell, but...
You can even keep her Power of the Wild, but is that better than Fandral Power of the Wild? I mean, you get like...
Uh-huh.
A little bit more.
Keep her Power of the Wild.
Keep her Power of the Wild again, this time by making a Tiger and a 2-2.
So you make a 3-3 and a 4-4.
It's not that good. 3-2.
You make
just
the Tiger.
Make the Tiger.
Okay.
Because you have like for sure one minion surviving if there is nothing, and even if he makes the value trade, let's say with the rough card, still have good options. But yeah, this is also looks really powerful.
Yeah, this just puts the most stuff. If he doesn't draw like an attack buff, then he all of a sudden can't.
This is going to be a really impactful soul fight.
Are you going for the 50-50?
I mean, it's pretty good
you have
soul fight here.
And then, well, if you're going to use Soulfire, what do you use it on?
I mean, you want to play Doomguard anyway, but yeah. It's like,
Let's go for the 50-50.
Oh, Eddie gets it.
Oh, wow. That's really good, right?
Yeah.
Now what?
but still, Swipe is going to be okay.
Well, unless you trade in
both
the...
Curve, but okay.
Unless you trade in both the lower minions.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Is that better, keeping the Doomguard healthy? Doomguard, if you trade it, it's going to be at 3 health. And then you'd keep alive a Wrathguard? Okay.
Oops. That's a problem right now because you have all those cards for 4 mana and you want to play 2 at least instead of Hero Power and having 1 mana left.
I think still Life Curse play spot is pretty decent. Like, you can just decide to go for the Mind Keeper here with an Hero Power. Your turn 8 is nice with Swipe. Soul of the Forest, and you still have then the turn... Or the turn 8 is nice, and then you have the turn 9.
I think it's the only play.
I don't think the Swipe is good here, and not necessary, because you're going to fall even more behind. One minion survives, there are going to be 1 or 2 more minions, and then you cannot react, so you have to be a bit more proactive here and just drop your minion.
Yeah.
Yeah, I don't see anything.
You can consider the ramp from the Mind Keeper, that's the only thing, but...
No.
I don't like it.
To play scenarios?
Yeah. And I mean, the 2-2 doesn't really trade in anything at the moment.
It can make for a better swipe.
You have a decent turn 8, so... I don't think you want to ramp up here.
Oh.
He did.
I think I would have preferred the 2-2 here, but knowing Life Coach, considerable how valuable like Mana Crystal can be, gives his preferences. Like,
got to make use of that golden Cenarius as fast as possible.
Yeah, but now with your 2-2.
Yeah, but now you see how big the 2-2 is.
The perfect swipe. Yeah. Oh, feels bad.
Yeah.
I mean, he's committed to play Thenarius and to trade the 3-3 into a 6-3.
Not really.
Well, swipe
you can
is
still
okay.
Swipe.
Yeah, swipe is okay, of course.
Swipe with either Soul of the Forest or Hero Power, but...
No, Hero Power
clear
Hero
the
power.
Board. And then he set up a clean board for Thenarius next turn. But imagine if he had that too.
Yeah, like then it was like Soul of the Forest swipe, and it was just like there was almost no way then 6-0 really had to just go phase only and... Hope that he can win that game.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think I'm a little bit unnecessary to go for the really scenarios play here. After the not making a 2-2.
This is actually not a risky play, but... definitely a greedy play. He Life Coach holds on to spell removal really heavily.
Oh, this top deck is insane as well. 5 more damage going through the face. He has no more Soulfires left, but 1 Doomguard.
Yeah.
But I don't see a way to... Ah, yeah, you can clean the board. 2 HP is going to be left.
But you can't...
You can't...
I mean, you don't really want to drop Emperor here with the knowledge and leaving a 1-1 up, right?
No, because it increases the chances to draw into lethal. With abuse,
yeah, it's like
everything.
It's
but how much? We've already seen Lance Carrier.
Oh wait a second. This deck is not playing the 0 mana spell. This zoo is not playing Forbidden Ritual.
They don't even
play Power Overwhelming either.
Oh, that changes a lot.
They're also not playing with the Councilman, for example.
Yeah, no Councilman.
Like, it's a really different.
So,
list.
What are the odds for 6-0 to deal? To draw into lethal.
Well, he's got a Dark Peddler left.
Uh huh.
That's a Soulfire. He's got both Argent Horse Riders. Both Argent Horse Riders.
No, one.
One Argent Horse Rider. One Doomguard.
Uh huh.
Well, if he leaves something up,
then a lot of things.
He's got Abusive Archer. He's got Lance Carrier.
Okay.
Direwolf also.
He goes for it.
Yeah. Direwolf's also not.
Yeah.
And the second Doomguard. Bolt Blocker ain't one. And
Doomguard.
The second Doomguard coming there. Wow.
Yeah.
Well, I guess whether or not he Hero Powered or not wouldn't have mattered. He would have lost anyway.
Well, so. the odds were on Sixo's favor right now.
So that might come down to the turn where he played Scenarios instead of swiping away the board.
Nah, took an extra 5 damage. Especially the Mind Keeper. Like the Mind Keeper that can make the 2-2 where the swipe afterwards, even together with the Soul Forest. Like it was pretty amazing. Like the curve was really good then. Bit of the greedy approach here, and not paying off, sadly.
Yeah, this deck that Zixo plays, it's more of an aggressive zoo. After a certain point, it kind of just ignores the minions on the board and goes face. Because it doesn't run a lot of trading tools. It doesn't have reload. It doesn't run Forbidden Ritual. It doesn't have like Darkshire Councilman. So it doesn't have any reload potential. So basically it relies on just going face after a certain point. It even runs an Argent Commander.
Yeah, oh,
the 6 drop. So.
Yeah, I saw it. I saw it before. And that deck has like really no comeback tools at all.
No,
right?
None. So you sort of have to go face after a certain point, because if your opponent ever does clear the board, like Life Coach did at the end there, they're so low that you have so many outs in your deck that are going to win the game. So clearing the board is actually really important, because you don't want them to get face damage. And that's another reason why playing the Mire Keeper to get the 2-2 is more important, because you want things to trade because you know that they're going to go face anyway.
Yeah, that's true. And now what do you think, Tides? Life Coach is going to...
He will play his Rogue, for sure.
Rogue?
Yeah.
Against this zoo?
There is like the Rogue. It is already like a decent matchup against the zoo with like all the like anti-aggro tools that you have with Prep, Backstep, SI, and Edwin is good. But the deck, even like the Rogue from Life, which is quite tacked, even more tools to deal with the early game of the zoo.
Yeah, it actually does pretty well against the C'Thun Warrior as well. So when you fall behind in last year's standing, you want to look not to just the next matchup, but you need to make back the loss, so you have to look to the next 2 matchups.
Mm-hmm. And Sixo's start is just insane.
Oh wow!
If you don't find Backstab as a rogue here without the coin, you will not be able to play SC7 Agent or Prep, maybe Prep something. Yeah.
Squire is also a card that is one of the cards in the rogue deck here, so might also help a little bit. But yeah, definitely the Backstab really important pickup here. If that.
Yeah, because otherwise we can see 5 turns game with this aggressive.
it's possible, yeah.
This zoo is just too aggressive.
If a Lance Carrier comes out and it sticks, because Lance Carrier buff is permanent.
Yeah.
It's like what Abusive Sergeant used to be.
Ooh. Look at this backstab.
Well, this is actually going to be real. I think even facing double flame imp here.
Yeah, you can
because
handle
that's kind of what I expect. Do you just pass, right?
Yeah, you have to take the
because
damage,
you want to take it turn 3, you want to backstep SI.
You cannot, yes, of course.
You're not, you are never going to backstep here at turn 2.
No, you just hero power pass. And you have an ice curve. I mean, that changed a lot the game right now.
And, because I mean, he's going to take... What,
6 damage?
Eight damage. Because Bragg's just going to die Wolf Alpha next turn.
Oh. Oh, yeah.
So, but it's worth it.
So you kill... If Sixer plays the Dire World Alpha, you kill both 3-2s and you leave the Dire World Alpha.
Yeah, because the Flame Imp just covers the SR7 too good, I think. Mm-hmm. Also, Dire Wolf alone on a board is not as good as Dire Wolf being on board with a lot of tokens or other minions.
There, yeah. It does get punished by Horse Rider, but...
Oh, that's true.
Oh, wow, that's true.
So maybe... But then, if you leave the Flame Imp up, it dies anyway, so...
Yeah.
You leave the Direwolf Alpha up because the chance if you leave Flame Imp up, it dies anyway.
Even if there will be an Horse Rider, then you can still like Hero Power into it and play your Pillager because that is gonna be your turn 4.
Are you gonna play Tomb Pillager on turn 4 or Violet Teacher?
Probably Tomb Pillager.
I'm pretty sure you will play Pillager because then you even get the coin for the Teacher. Like Pillager has to test the board and then Teacher can get on. The Dark Iron Skulker.
This card is good.
Imagine if it will be on this board like in 2 turns. Yeah. Like it just chucks everything away.
It's not as good against this version of Zoo.
Because of No Forbidden Ritual, you mean?
Because of No Forbidden Ritual. And because some of the minions are a little bit more resilient. Like if you get a Young Priestess down on the board and it buffs a 2 health minion to 3 health. Like Young Priestess plus Dark Peddler. It becomes a little more awkward. Also, there's more Divine Shields in this deck with Archer Commander, Horse Rider.
It's good anyway.
Oh, yeah, it's good anyway.
Because it's like a 5-mana 4-3 deal. I mean...
Clear the board from a soup quite
not
often.
Not clean, but just...
Draw 7 like, backstabs.
Yeah, 7 backstabs or 5 backstabs. Yeah. Even 3 or 2 is just good enough, right?
Even and, 1 backstab is good enough.
The cool thing is, it's not only this matchup, but you see how much like Yogg-Truths are around, and like just against all the tokens from the teacher, it's just really good.
Guys, that was a top deck.
Wow, it happened. That's still okay though. He can still attack in, but I mean.
Now Violet Teacher, right?
Not sure.
I think you play Violet Teacher backstab.
I still don't mind. Yeah, the Pillager dies to an Solfi, and that is I think another reason to really go for this teacher. Yes. Otherwise, I think it would have been a little bit close.
Next turn, you're gonna play. Maybe Tomb Pillager and Cold Blood, or maybe the guy.
But I guess it just really depends what Sixo's going to do here for Life Witch, though.
I mean, to be honest, this game is very close to already being over.
Yeah, but that is a bit of the playstyle of both decks. Like Rogue being a good anti-aggro class if with the anti-aggro tools if you get them. Zoo not being having any comeback mechanic if it falls behind.
Yeah. All right, I think you just Dark Iron Skulker trade in the 1-1 and go. Eviscerate doesn't fit in well here.
I hope Life Coach knows there is no Forbidden Ritual because I'm not so certainly sure about that.
He may not know this deck.
His Starlighter list did not have Forbidden Ritual. And this is almost the exact same lineup than his Starlighter list.
It's the same one.
He made a couple changes to Shaman.
Okay.
He put in a Lightning Bolt and took out one of the heavier drops. I forgot which one.
I actually think we might see a Pillager Cold Blood play here from Life Coach trading the 1-1 into the ref card. Probably, I don't like it more, but I think that's... I don't think Life Coach really has the information that Forbidden Ritual is the card that is cut. And if there is one comeback mechanic from 6-0 now, it might be Forbidden Ritual.
Yeah. If that's on his mind, then that's what he's going to do.
I just know him too good.
Yeah, you do.
I think so, man.
It's like, I know like what are getting into our minds, and I know... that he sees what is the win condition for 6-0 here, and he just wants to play around it.
Yeah. Also, he gets more damage to face this way because he trades a lot of damage into the... Mm-hmm.
I mean, the play is still working out pretty well.
Yeah.
There's both here. Yeah. 6-0 doesn't want to face another rope turn. That's just the main reason. If there's somebody that doesn't like their turn face the rope every turn, it's probably 6-0.
It's a... That deck especially, even more so than normal Zoo, when it loses the board, it loses the game.
Yeah.
Unless you put a lot of damage on early on, unless you're by the time you lose the board, your opponent's like 10 health, you're pretty much screwed. But it does have better matchups against Warriors, which is weird because Zix actually banned Warrior. It's the Dex is a lot more resilient to work because you have less.
I think Sixo really had a strategy banning Zoo, but Life Coach is not running Zoo, so he kind of had a little bit more of a free ban, I think.
And I think this Zoo is better against Rogue, I could say, but with this start, there's nothing you can do.
Yeah.
But I think it's just too good against Rogue because you go face, and Rogue is like. Why weak did at the beginning.
Whoa. Why is Sixo picking the Druid over the Warrior into Rogue? What kind of Warrior will be really bad against Rogue?
He's got C'Thun Warrior. C'Thun Warrior, I think, is pretty rough against Rogue. Because they don't have a way to deal with
Oxygen. Yeah, but I mean, you kind of know what Life Coach is playing, the techs he's running, and if there's one class it's just not good against, it's probably C'Thun Warrior.
Yeah, but Druid is good against Rogue right now because when you do the combo with Power of the Wild, there is no more Blade Furies. It's hard to remove the minions. Sometimes Auctioneer comes late.
So Life Coach has Shaman left.
His Shaman left.
So
mid Shaman.
Maybe he wants to have the C'Thun Druid, the C'Thun Warrior also a little bit for the Shaman.
No, I don't think so.
Okay.
I don't think so.
Maybe he thought it was Conquest and he just randomed.
I think it's just...
I don't think so.
I mean, the Druid is just okay against Rogue right now, I think. I'm not sure, but...
That's a close matchup, but I thought like a lot of Warriors will like be really good against it, and I wasn't sure it was indeed the C'Thun Warrior.
Yeah. All right, well... Argent Squire plus the coin. Life Coach already has Gadget and Auctioneer. A lot of times, unless there's a big innervate play, Druids will give you time.
Yeah.
Even these Druids nowadays, they are a bit more, a little bit slower in that kind of perspective in the turn 2-3. Mm-hmm. Even the 4 drop, not that appealing with the Mind Keeper, so gets a lot of time.
Hero Power, you kill the Divine Shield.
I think he wants to find the innervate really badly. Oh.
I like keeping Wrath because there are a lot of 3-3s that you want to heal almost
not
immediately.
Sure. Your hand is like super crap, what you have here for the next 2, 3, 4 turns even. Like you really have to get like in turn 6 to make this deck powerful.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Or have innervates. One or the other. Well, Thorstein can help, but it's still a long ways away.
So... Actually, the Squire not doing anything for Life Coach, making the hero power from Sixo a little better while he was doing what they've done anyway.
Yeah. And now he just has a reactive hand, so he can't even use the backstab to try and make a bigger Bancleave. Because there's nothing to backstab. Mm,
is Fen of Knives a cycle card in this matchup?
I don't think so. It's Violet Teachers.
Yeah, that's risky. Violet Teacher, Living Roots. But I mean, I guess a lot of times if your opponent's going to go for Violet Teacher, they're going to Power Wild at the same turn.
I mean, you have a Skullcrawl also in the deck for these kind of situations. But
if you see Fan of Knives being played, you will play Violet Teacher without Power of the Wild. You can play Violet Teacher.
I mean, it still dies to Backstep SI. It even dies to Shadow Strike. There's an Abyss with like the hero power and Deadly Poison with an SI, I think. Sixo can expect the teacher never surviving if you play that turn 4.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
It's still like probably the play anyway, because you want to do like at least do something. At turn 5, the same will happen.
Mm-hmm.
But I don't think you can really
expect to survive.
Yeah.
Which deck is going to do more if given time? Is it Rogue just because of Auctioneer?
Rogue has the swing turns. Like Rogue can really swing around. If it is ahead, I think Druid has a hard time getting back.
Yeah. Yeah. The Sixo realized it just goes ahead and plays the Violet Teacher, but
Now you can like Shadow Strike, which is the natural play, or
I like coin
eviscerate.
I like coin eviscerate
Edwin.
Hit and then Edwin.
Yeah, that's what I was.
Oh.
It's a decent Bancleave. If he doesn't have mulch, you are already way ahead.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And if they have mulch...
Also, Auctioneer is still really far away. Like, it's not that you want to even play that turn 6 at this point.
Mm-hmm.
So, I think you really want to get that now on board.
Yeah.
Edwin is at his strongest now. Like, Druid just passed some turns, didn't play any reactive. Druid wants to play his 4, 5, 6 drops now.
And it's going
to
be 8-8, right? So it's really
depends
big.
How he does it.
I would have just made it a 6-6 and like, saved the backstab.
Yeah, and your hero power in it, you mean?
Yeah, yeah.
Oh. I think I could have make this exactly play.
It's a bit how much you value the backstab at this point. Yeah. If it's worth the use and the plus two.
Oh, there's Yaxxaron drawn, but still quite a bit of ways away.
Such a not a good, like Sixu just doesn't get anything going. Without the innervate, without the wild growth, this is one of the matches where you just have to do something. Otherwise, you give the rogue time and they just gonna do their own stuff and react your stuff away. So really painful strategy that Sixu has to take.
Yeah, to be fair, if that Edwin Van Cleef was a 6-6, he could swipe Living Roots.
that's true.
Mm-hmm. I mean, not that that's something that you play around. I mean, maybe Life Coach thought about it. He said, 5 mana, yeah. What punishes me? Exactly swipe Living Roots. But
he's going to do it anyway and hope for a Wrath or just play Savage Roar next turn? Oh, what? Wait, what?
I think he can. Oh, and the Skull Cure.
Okay, but Fan of Knife was good enough, but now it's just insane.
Yeah. Ah, well, Skull Cure also good here.
Skull Cure just hit him in the face for 8.
I thought that Living Roots went to deal 2 damage for the Van Cleef, but then I saw 2 1-1s and I was like, what?
Yeah, but what does the 2 damage do? Like, even if it's an 8-2, you still don't kill it.
Yeah, but you want to play Savage for next turn, right? Or just...
I don't know. It feels kind of like desperate. He didn't have anything.
You have an 8-8 on board. Not right now, 8-4. I mean, it's 8 damage per turn.
Yeah, but there's just no good tool to deal with it. I mean, Savage Roar and taking 24 from Edwin is not optimal either. Like,
no.
Or no, it's 16. You take 16. 16. But, yeah. I kind of really go towards the Skulker here, just for the curve, yeah.
And it's a 4-3. If you can deal with an 8-4, now you have an 8-4 and a 4-3. You are going to end the game as fast as you can.
Yep.
6-0, no waiting, just dropping the Emperor here.
This is lethal, right?
Yeah, that's lethal. Just Leroy Jenkins, so that's going to do it.
Oh, wow, such a fast game in the favor of Rogue. And yeah, Rogue still can be just so powerful in the early games. I don't know, like, I feel Rogue just has a super good win rate here overall. Like, there are not many people bring it, but if you bring it, you ban, like, a weak matchup away, and then overall, like, there's just not much weak links left.
And then you look at what you're going to be facing later on if you make it past this point, and it's Concede Shamans, which Rogue does great against because Sap.
Really good.
Yeah.
Like, Rogue just... In general, really good Last Hero Standing deck. There's always been a deck that wasn't Last Hero Standing popular just because it is a deck that can 3-0 it. And it can be used as a counter. And there are not many decks that can do both together.
Yeah, definitely.
But how can be Rogue good in like Shaman meta, Zoo meta?
Well, Zoo is fine.
Yeah,
Zoo is fine.
You have so, and Shaman is the ban. So there are not many Rogues here. I don't think you have Rogues that are not banning Shaman.
And how is the match Rogue against Tempo Mage?
That's fine. I mean, you can see it a little bit as a Zoo where the Tempo Mage is a bit more reactive, and that's a problem. Mm-hmm. So I would say it is a close one.
Yeah, Tempo Mage just has a little bit more burn, so you have to watch like your life total earlier. But there actually isn't that many Tempo Mages left. What, Hot Form has Tempo Mage?
Yeah, there are some. Jackie Chan.
Oh, Jackie Chan, I don't know if he...
They're facing each other. Like,
he was in the decider match on the Eastern Man, I think. So.
Do you keep Gachetan if you know it's control?
Yeah, it's your best card.
So you keep
not close.
Backstab and Deadly Poison as well?
Not even sure if you keep them. Like,
maybe not Backstab?
You want minions. You want like Tomb Pillager, Azure Drake. Those are your best drops. Maybe Backstab just because you need a way to deal with C'Thun's Chosen. I don't know. C'Thun's Chosen like the toughest card to deal with because you have to hit it twice.
Maybe just Deadly Poison and Gachetan.
Like, the thing you don't want is keeping too many spells because then you're not going to do anything before your gadgets then.
Yeah.
So I'm not sure.
Whoa! Ooh.
I'm not
Does
sure
he
if
not
he
boom.
Maybe he doesn't
it
know.
It might be that he just doesn't know what kind of warrior he is facing. And this is really hurting the mulligan.
Yeah.
And that's why, like, keeping spells against like Cthulhu Warrior just is not what you want.
Yeah.
You just get all these spells, you're not finding much use out of them.
Did Sixo play this warrior in the tournament or
he did, yeah.
He really did?
Yeah.
Okay. Because like yesterday he didn't, and I
earlier,
guessed
he did match earlier today in his match versus Orange, I think. Yeah, because he lost. So if you lose, you play all three.
Yeah, if it's not banned, I mean, I don't know what the ban was, but
Druid was banned, I think, in his first series.
Is that Cthulhu Dragon?
No, I know there are like a lot of Cthulhus even putting in the Deathwing.
It's just got just like a reset. Mm-hmm. Yeah, well, I'm gonna lose
like
this game.
Like a more consistent Jokin board clearing, I would say. I don't know what.
Yeah. Deathwing is the OG Yogg-Saron.
No, but also when you play Cthulhu Warrior, you are pretty much always out of cards. So Deathwing is just another threat, but also it's easy to play without cards. So
yeah,
I like it.
Yeah.
Because back days, when you played Control Warrior, you had almost always 8 cards on your hand. But with Cthulhu, you just play the minions. You draw pretty much everything. Maybe you save some removals, but you have always 2, 3, 4 cards on your hand. So Deathwing is easier to play at least.
Yeah, that makes sense. Makes a lot of sense. And what is Life Coach deciding here?
Yeah, I'm dropping SI, maybe scared of a Vorax. Like, does it do anything doing it here?
He wants to coin Azure Rig next turn.
Or just deadly SI next turn.
No. Okay.
I also go more towards like the Azure Drake, but I'm not... ooh, finding Pillager. But what he was probably setting up here is just making a trade in the Cthulhu Chosen. Like, predicting the turn 4 from the Warrior. What is the Cthulhu Chosen normally? And you just have the free trade on board, so you can do whatever you want.
Yeah,
but if he already know that Cthulhu Chosen, I mean, if he knows that Sixo is playing Cthulhu, he would have kept.
I think it's just because turn 2 pass, turn 3 pass.
Okay.
It kind of goes towards more in control deck. I don't think there are many Dragon Warriors doing that often, and they also they have the Warrix, they just play it.
Like it's Warrax, Fairy Dragon, Alexstrasza's Champion. Frothing Berserker if they play it.
I don't know things. Yeah. Blood to Ichor.
Well, Blood to Ichor on the Art and Squire. So.
Even a Ghoul maybe, like whatever.
Even a Ravaging Ghoul just for 3 because Ravaging Ghoul doesn't do that well against Rogue anyway. I don't know. Yeah, I think that might have just been a read. I don't know, we'll ask him. If he wins, we'll sit him down and we'll grill him.
This is standard Rogue because he's so Cthulhu Chosen and he has to like think about everything again. Like,
yeah. He has to reset his mind.
Yeah.
Which for Life Coach takes like 5 turns.
That is not something particularly because he didn't predict this turn. It's just something, why not take the use of the turn that I have anyway?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Like, why would I not do it?
Yeah, but the way I think about it is, at least in my mind, I overthink things a lot.
You?
Yeah, so if I take all my time on my turn, I'll end up making the worst play. Because I'll find the best play, and then I'll be like, maybe it's not the best play. Yeah.
For Life Coach, it's mainly... For Life Coach, mainly just making, like, he does it too, and then just considers, is it worth it or not, like, making the...
I think Life Coach is just trolling everybody, and he actually only thinks about his turn seconds.
You should watch your practice matches sometimes, and then there are, like, even more.
No. And then the rest of his turn, he, like, thinks about, what am I going to eat for dinner later?
I see his stream sometimes, and he's, like, thinking in... thousand things at the same time.
I watched his stream one time, and he lost a game. He opened up his deck collection, and he sat there with his hands on his temples, just staring at his... He went to 2 drops, the first page of 2 drops. He put his hand on his temples, and he stared at his screen of 2 drops for 20 minutes. He didn't move his mouse. He didn't move his head. He moved his fingers a little bit, like to like wipe his hair or something like that. 20 minutes. That's all he did.
So now Rogue is just a bit ahead, I would say.
I think it's
way ahead. Backstab here. Instead of using the
Oh, what?
I mean, look at his hand. He's got double cold blood. He's got conceal and deadly poison. So he's got a lot of burst.
Okay.
He's going to try and end the game quick, it looks like.
Okay. Yeah, and I think he's keeping the concealer a little, like expecting maybe something here. And then you have to conceal whenever like the warrior wants to remove. Like just checking the board a bit, like what do you have? Do you have some single removal? Okay, now it's fine to use. And if you don't, then I will go with the conceal next turn.
So maybe hero power, deadly poison, cold blood, conceal?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, like the deadly poison is just good already here. And I don't think there is like even a brawl vault that help anything on this board. Like if there are two minions concealed, like, yeah, it's going to win against one, but it's going to lose against the other one.
Do you sap the Jessicar Chuhart to guarantee that a minion lives brawl?
You can kill it off with deadly poison. Like,
oh, yeah, that's
true. Mind that.
Yeah, yeah. So that would be 3 mana. Double cold blood would be 5 yeah. mana. And conceal would be 6 mana.
Okay, goes for the more aggressive play.
Well, do you still set up for lethal if you have to use a deadly poison attack into the Jessicar Chuhart?
That's a good question. It was 9, 13. 13 this turn. So
I cannot see anything.
You don't. You set up lethal anyway.
Yeah, and I cannot see Life Purge not doing it here. Like, Cold Blood can be a bit... It's one of the most clunky cards, but it's just a strong card overall. And if you find any use, like, you probably just take it.
I mean, you are sapping a 6-mana minion for two, so...
Now he doesn't conceal, though, unless he doesn't want to use Deadly Poison.
Oh, we're going to use Conceal, right? Oh, what?
He's going to coin Conceal.
No, he's going to coin Deadly.
He coined Deadly, yeah.
Oh, what?
Just goes for the maximum damage.
Well, I mean, I guess, like, how do you remove this? He's still got 3 damage from...
No, but you're gonna have now hero power, shield block. Like, shield slam.
Something like that.
Or what?
Or just execute.
But conceal was just too clear.
Well, it doesn't matter anyway.
Doesn't matter at all.
He doesn't have it, so...
Yeah.
Wow. Alrighty. That means Life Coach is the second player to move on from Group A. And he's going to join Zalay as the two players from Group A. I dubbed it the Group of Death. Mm-hmm. And we'll get Life Coach over here to make room for him, guys.
Yes, of course, Life Coach. Congratulations.
All right. Okay.
Congrats, man.
Sick.
How does it feel?
I don't know. I don't know about the last turn. I really don't know.
Which one?
What, you were going to conceal?
The conceal one, yeah.
I think conceal was a really good consideration there. There are some like turns where there might be like just a tank up and the cold already being shield slam being played, and with something else, cold have been a bit rough. But
he would have played it before, right? And I was thinking like his best turn is like 10 armor or taunt guys. And if taunt guys or 10 armor, then the conceal is complete nonsense.
And he didn't even stack his cocoon yet. Like the
he played 4 times two cartoon
chosen. Okay,
so I was thinking like I play around the best answer by inflicting the
Did you know that it was a Cthune warrior before the game started?
Thais as my advisor advised me that it's a dragon warrior.
Yeah, I thought it was a dragon warrior.
Because we were thinking, would you have kept Auctioneer? Because you had Auctioneer in the mulligan.
Yeah.
If you knew it was Cthune Warrior?
I don't think so.
You wouldn't have kept Auctioneer?
Would you? Oh, with the conceal? Did I have conceal? No.
No,
you had Backstab, Deadly Poison,
Deadly Poison, Fahrenheit,
You keep Auctioneer in Cthune?
I think on the coin is pretty strong, right?
Yeah, maybe.
I mean,
but
it's
super
like the
slow too.
Yeah.
But against Cthune, it may be your win condition.
I think against Control Warrior I would, but against a Cthune I'm not sure because like you can also lose. Like if they play Cthune you can also lose. Mm-hmm. So it's not like that you have infinite time. So you have to pull in some pressure at the beginning. But yeah.
And then in the Druid against the Zoo matchup, you played Mind Keeper for mana on turn 7 to play on Cure your scenarios.
Yes.
You had a decent turn 8, like Swipe plus Soul of the Forest.
Yeah, but Soul of the Forest is not very decent, is it?
Well, it was on Cure, but at least. But the thing is, if you play the Choo-Choo, you have a really good swipe there. If you don't play the Choo-Choo, you can play Scenarios, of course. But I don't think it's worth it.
No, I can hear you. I was definitely thinking about this, and I was wondering whether like 3-3-2-2 will have a big board impact, but... My decision went towards that Soul of the Forest. Well, probably I will have one minion at the beginning of the next turn. Mm-hmm. So I was simply deeming Swipe and Soul of the Forest a very weak alternative to the scenarios. And but By the way, very weak. Like, just closer, but a little bit weaker. Mm-hmm. So it would have changed with any top deck. So I was really wondering whether I should go for the top deck, because Hall of the Forest was really not
Of course, of course.
No. But I think it was the swipe call had been really good there afterwards. So the 2-2, the minion, all the minions would either trade or on at B and 1 HP.
True.
So call maybe work out.
Did you like to produce the Panther? I was really wondering.
Yes, we like it a lot.
With the battle teacher turn?
Yeah. Okay,
with the swipe in hand, it made a lot of sense. Also, the second one made also a lot of sense. Yeah. So. Yeah. Oh, really? Yeah. I think we really like that. Yeah.
Okay, cool.
So that's Rogue cool. is kind of, Rogue is dominating this tournament for like everybody that's bringing Rogue.
That was a good choice, right?
Yeah, definitely. But, oh, and the 1-1 Divine Shield Keep, did you like that?
Against?
No, against like in the last match. Like against Druid. I kept the 1-1 Divine.
Yeah, like on coin it gets really weak because it can run into the hero power from the Druid. Like you give it...
Against Warrior? No, I mean against Warrior.
Or against Druid, I mean. Because like he can just shapeshift it away if he doesn't have anything.
Yeah, kind of happened,
unfortunately. So
yeah,
the Squire probably took the hero power. If you go first, I would always keep it. If you go second, I'm not so sure. Like, it's quite a decent into, like, Living Roots and even into a Panther, maybe.
Right, yeah.
So there is a lot of reason. I think, like, if a Druid has this kind of a slow start, you are already happy, and then you are still fine with the Squire not doing that much.
I didn't even feel like any kind of... I mean, his throw must have been really, really crappy.
He had
crappy,
a lot of spells.
Like the Druid stuff.
He could have like played in Power of the Wild, but he had like expensive minions, an Emperor. He had like a lot of spells that were like Roar and this kind of stuff. Yeah. So, yeah, really, 6-0 had really like a reactive hand that you... not doing much.
Yeah, and of course, Leroy Jackie.
Yeah, well, the advent was really big. Like, if we were considering if the advent could be in 6-6, but going for the 8-8, going for the more aggressive advent, really paid off, because otherwise it would just have been traded away.
Yeah,
it's white
blingers. It would have been really close. So really, that the big advent really paid off there.
Yeah, that was really cool that he stayed the giant. Yeah.
So, awesome. Does Rogue have a weakness besides, obviously, Shaman? Because I don't think it doesn't feel like anything beats it right now.
I feel Tempo Mage is favorite, but I'm not sure. I didn't play that much. I'm not sure about this zoo. Because like it feels like it's so aggressive. And if you don't have backstab SC7 agent in turn 3, how can you deal with the early minions?
I mean, Dragon Warrior is still a little bit like tricky.
Rogue has been beating Dragon Warriors a lot this event, though.
It's tricky. It's difficult to play, but it's definitely like it doesn't have so unfavorite matchups. Like the worst matchup is probably -5. I mean, despite stuff like Freeze Mage, of course. I mean, Freeze Mage is obviously
well, you beat Chucky's Freeze Mage.
Yeah. But I also heard he was not 100% on spot. I mean, not surprisingly, I mean, he also has like a lot of jet lag. Like, we see him sleeping all day long, like on the couch downstairs. So, I guess he was definitely not playing A game, which was also to the advantage, of course. Yeah. But other than that, I simply think it's like Rogue is a very good choice because like everybody here is simply playing Zoo. It's simply good against Zoo. Like, very good, especially like with the tech here, with the dude. Like, he did do something, right? This he sliced 2-1-1s.
Yeah, and I even was like, we were like, yeah, Skulker at turn 5 was actually really good because the card that he cut it out of his deck was Forbidden Ritual. And I was like, Skulker is good. Yeah. And I said, no, Life Crush will go for the Cobblet Pillager play because
he doesn't run Forbidden Ritual.
I guess it. I was thinking he runs one. But it was also
the only comeback mechanic. So it was still like the really good play.
Yeah.
So
it was smart.
It was interesting.
Yeah. All right, man. Well, top 8. It's pretty good. Congratulations.
Oh, thank you very much.
Yeah. All right. Well, that's going to do it for Group A. Two people moving on. It's Life Coach and Zalay. And we still got plenty more action at CSUR Cup, so don't go anywhere, guys. More matches right after this.